Welcome everybody to Neat Then, and let us continue with our second chapter, that is biological classification. We will see part 3 today. So before moving to part 3, let us revise part 2. So in part 2 we have seen about kingdom Monera, which consists of a bacterial kingdom which are unicellular prokaryotes. So this kingdom Monera, we saw that is divided into two domains, that is Archaebacteria and Eubacteria. And we know that these Archaebacteria are extremophiles, which are primitive bacteria. They live in very extreme conditions in which other bacteria cannot live. And they have got a special cell wall that protects them from the external extreme environments. So the various examples of archaebacteria that we had seen were halophiles, which live in salty environment, thermoacidophiles, which live in the streams, the hot water springs, especially acidic hot water springs, and methanogens, which live in marshy lands, which are covered with water, the land which is covered with water for a long time. Methanogens are also seen in the gastrointestinal tract of ruminant animals like cows, buffalo, goat, etc. And they produce methane gas, which is a biogas. We also saw that kingdom Monera, apart from being divided into Archaebacteria, has also been divided as, has also been classified as Eubacteria. And Eubacteria are the true bacteria, and they are present everywhere in the environment. So these true bacteria can be divided depending upon their mode of nutrition into autotrophs, which may be photosynthetic autotrophs, as we had seen cyanobacteria. They may even be chemosynthetic autotrophs, like the nitrifying bacteria, sulfur bacteria, and so on and so forth. Or the Eubacteria most commonly are heterotrophic bacteria. We have also seen mycoplasma in part 2, which is also a type of bacteria which has some special features. We had also seen in part 2 that bacteria are divided into different types depending upon their shape. So there are cocci, there are bacilli, there are spirilla, and there are coma-shaped bacteria called as vibrio. And we had seen that bacteria mostly reproduce by binary fission, that is an asexual mode of reproduction, and sometimes under unfavorable conditions may also produce spores, and this is also an asexual mode of reproduction. But sometimes they reproduce by somewhat similar sexual mode of transmission by gaining the nuclear material, the DNA material from outside, but this is a rare condition. So today, let us see next kingdom, that is Kingdom Protista, amongst the 5 kingdom classification. So we will see Kingdom Protista today, and we are going to see Kingdom Protista in under these headings. That is chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, euglenoids, and slimoids. So, and also protozoans. So, what is Kingdom Protista? Kingdom Protista basically consists of eukaryotic cells, and they are mostly single-celled organisms. So, Kingdom Protista are single-celled eukaryotes. But there is a lot of confusion, as some of the microorganisms in kingdom Protista may appear like plants, some may appear like fungi, some may appear like animals. So there are no clear boundaries for this particular kingdom. Thus, this kingdom forms a link with others dealing with plants, animals, and fungi. So let us see the various types of protists and which ones resemble plants, animals, and fungi. So chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, and euglenoids are plant-like protists because they have pigments like plants and they are photosynthetic protists. So they are autotrophs. Whereas slime molds or water molds are fungus-like protists and they are heterotrophs. Similarly, protozoans are animal-like protists and they are also heterotrophs. So the kingdom Protista can be divided into plant-like protists, fungus-like protists, and animal-like protists. And plant-like protists are photosynthetics, whereas the animal-like and fungus-like protists are heterotrophs. Also, members of Protista are aquatic in nature. That means they live in water. And they have eukaryotic cells. So definitely these cells have a well-defined nucleus bounded by a nuclear membrane. And also they have the cell cytoplasm has many membrane-bound organelles like mitochondria, Golgi apparatus, ribosomes, liposomes, and so on and so forth. Also, some of these eukaryotes, some of these protists have flagellae, that is a single or double tail-like structures, or cilia, which are small hair-like structures. As far as the reproduction is concerned, the protists may reproduce asexually. Very commonly, they reproduce asexually by various methods like binary fission, as we had already seen in bacteria or kingdom Monera. There may be even multiple fissions. There may be fragmentation and hence reproduction, or there may be reproduction by spore formation. So fragmentation means breaking up, and there may be even reproduction by spore formation. At the same time, some of the protists show sexual mode of reproduction by processes which involve cell fusion and zygote formation. So let us see which of these protists show asexual and which show sexual mode of reproduction. So let us see the first protist, which is a plant-like protist, that is chrysophytes. And these chrysophytes, they are found in freshwater as well as in marine waters, in seawater also. And they include diatoms and golden algae. And they are planktons. That means these chrysophytes, they do not actively move in water by themselves, but their movement is because of the floating passively in water currents. So they float passively in water currents. Where the water moves, they also float along with that water. So such organisms are called as planktons. And most of them are photosynthetic. Diatoms, they are one of the chief producers in the oceans, like some algae and some bacteria also. They are chief producers in the oceans. So diatoms also are chief producers in the oceans. The cell of the diatoms possess of very thin overlapping shells which fit into each other like a soap box. So you can see this is an electron microscopic view of a cell of a diatom, and you find there are two very, very thin shell-like structures which appear to be fitting into each other like soapbox. But at the same time, these are also covered with such structures which form certain protrusions or some designs on the surface of this particular thin shell and certain patterns on the surface of the thin shell. And these are formed because of presence of silica on the surface of the cell. Silica is a very tough material and it is indestructible. Diatoms have left behind large amount of cell wall deposits in their habitats, and this accumulation over billions of years is referred to as diatomaceous earth. Now, this diatomaceous earth is very gritty. Gritty means it is very granular and tough. And hence this soil, which is diatomaceous soil, is used in polishing as well as in filtration of oils and syrups. Next, let us see dinoflagellates. So dinoflagellates are also plant-like protists like chrysophytes. So dinoflagellates, they are mostly marine. That means they are mostly present in the oceans, the seas, salt waters, and they are photosynthetic. They possess certain pigments like chlorophyll, carotene, prydenine in various forms and in various compositions, which gives them a range of colors. So they may be yellow in color, they may be green in color, they may be brown, blue, or red in color, depending upon the composition of the pigments. The cell wall of these dinoflagellates, as you can see, the cell wall of these dinoflagellates is made up of cellulose plates, which is very stiff, and they also possess flagellae. So they also possess flagellae, that is the tail-like structures, and they may be two in number. One mostly lies longitudinally, as you can see in here, and one may lie in between the two plates in the furrow, in between the two plates transversely. Very often, the dinoflagellates, especially the red dinoflagellates, which are present in the ocean or in the sea, which are called as goniolocks, undergo rapid multiplication, converting the sea into red sea, red tides. That is what we call as red tides. So the entire sea appears red, and they may also produce toxins which may kill other marine animals, such as fishes. Next, moving to euglenoids, which are also plant-like protists. So these euglenoids are mostly freshwater organisms, which are mostly present in stagnant water with a lot of organic waste. So these euglenoids, the cell body of these euglenoids, does not possess a cell wall, but it possesses a protein-rich layer covering the entire cell, which is called a spellicle, as a result of which the body of this euglenoid becomes more flexible. So if the cell wall is there, then it becomes, the body is rigid. But because of absence of cell wall and presence of protein-rich layer, that is spellicle, the body of these euglenoids become more flexible. They can move and change their shape as per the requirements. They have two flagella, and one flagella is long and the other flagella is short. They are also photosynthetic, especially in the presence of sunlight. They have pigments identical to those present in the higher plants. So in the presence of sunlight, they are photosynthetic. But if they are deprived of sunlight, they behave like heterotrophs and they predate on other small organisms. So these are eublenoids. Next, coming to fungus-like protists, that is slime mold. And this slime mold is a saprophytic protist. So we have seen that fungus-like and animal-like protists are heterotrophs. And slime molds, they are saprophytic heterotrophs. That means they feed on dead plants and animals. So this slime mold moves along decaying twigs and leaves, engulfing organic material. We may find them easily around our in our environment. So under suitable conditions, these slime molds form large aggregates, which are called as plasmodium, which may become large in size, grow rapidly. During unfavorable conditions, these plasmodium differentiates to form fruiting bodies, fruit-like bodies, which bear spores on their tips. These spores, they possess truvals, and they can be dispersed with the help of air currents. And these spores are very resistant, extremely resistant, and may survive for many years under adverse conditions also. So this was slime mold, which is a fungus-like protist. And lastly, moving to protozoans, which are animal-like protists. So all the protozoans are heterotrophs, and they may live as predators or parasites. So they are believed to be primitive relatives of animals. And there are four major groups of protozoans, that is amoeboid protozoans, flagellated protozoans, ciliated protozoans, and sporozoans. So let us see each one of them. So amoeboid protozoans, they are like amoeba. Everybody knows amoeba. It can change its shape. It's unicellular. It can change its shape, and it can produce foot-like processes called as pseudopodia, which can engulf the food materials inside their bodies. So they live in fresh water. They may even live in seawater, or even they may live in moist soil. Marine forms of amoeba, they have silica shells on their surfaces. So they move and capture their prey by putting out pseudopodia or false feet, as in case of amoeba. And so they look like amoeba. They behave like amoeba. And some of them, such as entamoeba, are also parasites. So, you know, we often suffer from a disease called as amoebiasis, which is basically caused by one type of entamoeba, which is called as Entamoeba histolytica. Then moving on to flagellated protozoans. So these flagellated protozoans have got flagella, that is a hair-like, a tail-like filament, a tail-like structure, which helps it to move. The members of this group are either free living, not dependent on other organisms, or are parasitic. So they have flagella, hence called as flagellated protozoans. The parasitic forms may cause diseases in human beings, like a disease called as sleeping sickness, which is caused by trypanosoma. So you can see in the picture that this is a blood of a patient suffering from sleeping sickness, in which we can see this parasite, that is trypanosome. Next, moving to ciliated protozoans. So you can find in the ciliated protozoans, the entire body of the protozoan is covered with thin hair-like processes, which help it to move. So they are aquatic, actively moving organisms, because the cilia are present all over the body, which are thousands in number. Many, many cilia are present all around the body. They also have a cavity, which is called as a gullet, that opens to the outside of the cell surface. And the coordinated movements of the cilia causes water, which is laden with food, to enter into the gullet. So this is the way they feed. So the example is paramecium. Let us move on to sporozoans. So sporozoans, they are protozoa, which are quite related with us. Everybody knows the disease called an infection called as malaria. I'm sure everybody must have heard about malaria. And the parasite which causes malaria is a sporozoan, that is Plasmodium. So everybody is aware that malaria is caused by mosquito bite. Mosquito, which is Anopheles mosquito, carries this parasite, that is Plasmodium, in its blood. And when it bites us, then it transfers the parasite inside the body. So we suffer from malaria. So malarial parasite falls under sporozoans. These sporozoans include diverse organisms that have an infectious spore-like stage in their life cycle. So remember, this spore-like stage is infectious. It can spread. The mosquito, when it bites one person having malaria, suffering from malaria, gets the parasite, and when it bites other person, it can transmit this parasite to the next healthy person. So most notorious of them is Plasmodium, which is a malarial parasite which produces malaria. Many deaths occur because of malaria all around the world every year. So various types of malarial parasites like Plasmodium falciparum, malariae, vivax. The most dangerous is Plasmodium falciparum. Apart from that, other sporozoans which also cause diseases in human beings like Toxoplasma gondii, pneumocystitis carinii, and so on and so forth. A characteristic feature of these sporozoans is that the reproduction cycle of these sporozoans have both asexual as well as sexual phases. So you can see in this picture, this is again the blood of a patient suffering from malaria, especially Plasmodium falciparum, which shows a gametocyte. This is a gamete. So there are male and female gametes present, and this also suggests a sexual mode of reproduction. Whereas there is production of structures called as schizoids, which suggests asexual mode of reproduction. So we end this class of Kingdom Protista here and hope you like this class, this video. If you understand it, please share it with your friends and subscribe to Neat Dairy.